We're going to start our carol service now. I'm just going to pray and then we're going to start by singing, O Come, All Ye Faithful. Lord God, thank you. Thank you that you are here with us. Thank you that you are not distant, God, but you are very real and very present. Holy Spirit, we welcome you today. Amen. Created, received its life from him, and his life gave light to everyone. The light keeps shining in the darkness, and the darkness never puts it out.
Those who walked in the dark have seen a bright light, and it shines upon everyone who lives in the land of darkest shadows. Our Lord, you have made your nation stronger. Because of you, its people are glad and celebrate like workers at harvest time or like soldiers dividing up what they have taken. You have broken the power of those who abused and enslaved your people. You have rescued them just as you saved your people from Midian. The boots of marching warriors and the blood-stained uniforms have been fed to flames and eaten by fire. A child has been born for us. We have been given a son who will be our ruler. His names will be Wonderful Advisor and Mighty God, Eternal Father and Prince of Peace. His power will never end. Peace will last forever. He will rule David's kingdom and make it grow strong. He will always rule with honesty and justice. The Lord All-Powerful will make certain that all of this is done.
I'd like to stand to sing a common compliment.
Yeah.
shepherds regarding their sheep. All at once, an angel came down to them from the Lord, and the brightness of the Lord's glory flashed around them. The shepherds were frightened.
Don't be afraid. I have the news for you, which will make everyone happy. This very day, in King David's hometown, a savior was born for you. He is Christ, our Lord. You will know who he is, because you will find him dressed in baby clothes, and lying on a bed of hay.
Praise God in the highest, and peace on earth to everyone who pleases God.
Oh my word, God is amazing.
God is awesome!
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Yeah.
Jerusalem.
Where is the child born to be king of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and we have come to worship.
When King Herod heard about this, he was worried, and so was everyone else in Jerusalem. Herod brought together the chief priests and the teachers of the law of Moses and asked them,
"Where is the Messiah born?"
"He will be born in Bethlehem, just like the prophet wrote. Bethlehem in the land of Judea, you are very important among the towns of Judea. From your town will come the shepherd who will be like a shepherd for my people Israel."
"When you first see the star, you should go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, let me know. I want to go and worship him too."
The wise men listened to what the king had said and then left. And the star they had seen in the east went on ahead of them until it was stopped over the place where the child was. They were thrilled and excited to see the star. When the men went into the house and saw the child with Mary, his mother, they knelt down and worshipped him. They took out their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh and gave them to him. Later they were warned in a dream not to return to Herod, and then went back by another road.
We're going to sing a song that you might not be so familiar with. Feel free to join in when you kind of get the measure of it. But it's about this theme, which we're going to be talking about more in a minute, of light. And then the way that the star showed a way for the kings to the place where the true light was.
Of peace. Good morning and welcome again, particularly to anyone who's visiting us this morning. It's wonderful to see you, although I can't really see very much with fogging glasses. It's a pleasure to be here with you. We weren't sure if we were going to make it. But I'm just going to spend a few minutes now. Like in a usual church service here, we would have a time of teaching from Scripture. And I just want to talk about this theme of light. And for me, when we were choosing, or Becca chose the readings and we chose the songs, these songs, these verses, they were all about the theme of light, and light against the darkness. This is the darkest time of year. I understand, I think it's Tuesday, that's the winter solstice, so the sun will rise here at about 3 minutes past 8, and it will set at 4:07, which gives you, if your maths are good, I think that's 7 hours and 50 minutes. My maths aren't good, but I haven't had time to think about it. So 7 hours and 50 minutes of daylight, and the rest is night. And if you go right the way up to the very northmost island in the British Islands, Isles, which is the island of Unst, and if you go to Skaw, which is the northmost settlement in the UK, daylight will last for 5 hours and 35 minutes, and night will last for 18 hours and 25 minutes. And even in an urban area like the places where we live, the streets on which we live, which are always full of light, even we find the lack of sunlight to be depressing. But I want you to spare a thought for the citizens of the town of Rykkinn in Norway. Becca, I wonder if you could change the slide. So this is an image, you might not be able to see it very well, but this is an image from a town in Norway called Rykkinn. I think I'm pronouncing that right. And it is located in a huge valley, and you can see the mountains on either side. Between September and March of every year, the town does not feel the direct touch of sunlight. Between September and March, no direct sunlight. And about 100 years ago, they built a funicular railway, one of the wet railways that go up the side of a hill. They built a funicular railway to the top of one of those mountains, so that the townsfolk could get on the funicular railway and go and feel the touch of the sun between September and March. Now, at a cost of 5 million Norwegian kroner, they've installed a sun mirror. And you can see the people standing in the light as it's reflected by the sun mirror that stands on the top of one of the mountains. They're desperate for light. They need light. I never thought of myself much as a city dweller. I come from the north of England and a sort of fairly, not very rural, but fairly rural area. But now, when I find myself in the dark, I feel uncomfortable. I feel like I need light. Otherwise, I'm stepping on Lego all over the house. So, what is this Christmas theme of light? Why are all our carols and all these verses and all these stories and songs full of light? Well, when the Bible speaks about darkness, it's talking about more than the mere absence of the sun. Did you know that if you read the first verses in the Bible, it begins in darkness? Let me read to you from the book of Genesis. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness and chaos were over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. Day and night, evening and morning. That's the first day of the creation story. Have you ever noticed, I'm just going to point this out, many of you will have noticed, but some of you maybe won't have noticed, that God doesn't create the sun and the moon and the stars until day four. So the light and the darkness thing happens on the first day, but before the sun and the moon and the stars. So what the Bible is saying is that there's darkness deeper than the mere absence of the burning ball in the sky a few million miles away. There's a darkness deeper than the absence of light. The darkness is an absence of God's created world. It's the world uncreated. Later on in the Bible, the prophet Isaiah, and we heard a reading from Isaiah, I think Alice read to us from Isaiah this morning, about the theme of darkness and light. Those living in darkness have seen a great light. That is the good news. The bad news, of course, is that darkness still exists. Read to you from Isaiah chapter 8. This starts in a bit of a strange place, but stay with me. When someone tells you to consult mediums and spiritists who whisper and mutter, should not people inquire of God? Why consult the dead on behalf of the living? Consult God's instruction and the testimony of warning. If anybody does not speak according to God's word, they have no light of dawn. Distressed and hungry, they will roam through the land. When they are famished, they will become enraged and look upward and curse their king and their God. Then they will look down to the earth and see only distress and darkness and fearful gloom, and they will be thrust into utter darkness. So when God creates, he creates, the first thing he creates is this light. But there is still darkness. Elsewhere, the prophet Isaiah calls Israel light to the nations. In these verses I just read, they're no such thing. They prefer hocus pocus, witches and spiritists to the clear light of the word of God. But it's not just that, is it? There is still darkness. There's darkness outside. But the worst darkness is the darkness inside. The darkness inside. The knowing compromises, the ways we hurt people, the pain we feel, the pain we cause, the wrong turns we take, the anger and bitterness that resides in each of us. That is a far more terrifying darkness. The darkness inside means that we stumble and trip and lose our way, even in our own minds. And we know this as individuals. Of course we know this as individuals. Have you never been overwhelmed by your own darkness? Have you ever done something and hurt someone so badly and you ask yourself, why did I do that? And there is no answer. It's just silence and darkness. We know it as individuals, or at least I do. And we know it as societies. There are so many things out there that just don't sit right. The hatred and resent, the corruption and greed. As we've been raising money over the Christmas period for people without recourse to public funds, we think of those that are still crossing the channel. people who have died because of the darkness. Corruption and greed in our own country. Sometimes when you open your social media feeds, it feels like you're lifting the lid on a sewer and the vilest resentment is flowing through our public life. There is a darkness inside and a darkness outside. What do we need? We need a light. Jesus, in the words of the Gospel of John, the true light that gives light to everyone. We celebrate this birth 2,000 years later because we believe that a light has come into our world and into our lives. This is God himself who comes. So comfortable are we with this Christmas message that we forget how subversive it is. In all other traditions, God is utterly transcendent of human weakness and the mess of human frailty and the mess of human life. The way out of our darkness is to find your way by some moral effort, by some self-enlightenment. Self-help, an entire genre of books that exist to persuade people that there are ways for us to escape our own darkness. This is not the Christian message. The Christian message is not a message where you help yourself. The Christian message is the one where help has come from outside. Jesus, our Emmanuel, one of these theological words, our Emmanuel, God with us, the incarnation, comes from the Latin word carne. God puts on flesh. God with us. Not God above us, not God beyond us, not God wishing us well from a distance, not God judging us from afar, but God living our life, suffering human pain, the light in the darkness. God writes himself into his own story. He doesn't send help. He is help. One of the church fathers, basically an old, really old, way old Christian bishop, said these words. Or preach these words on Christmas to speak of this incarnation. He said, man's maker was made man, the ruler of the stars, that he might nurse at his mother's breast, that the bread of life might hunger, that the fountain of life might thirst, that the light of life will sleep, the way of life be tired on its journey, that the truth might be accused of false witness, that the teacher might be beaten with whips, that the foundation of creation will be suspended on wood, that strength might grow weak, that the healer might be wounded, that life might die. God coming in to the darkness. We sentimentalize these scenes so much. But Jesus' life, from start to finish, was a story of light in darkness. Let me quote to you from another very honoured philosopher, Arsene Wenger. This is one for Kay. I'm told that he once said, where you are at Christmas is very important. He's speaking about Premiership title race, of course. Where you are at Christmas is important, but it's where you are at Easter that really counts. So, Premiership title race, but there's a deeper wisdom there. There never was a darker moment as on the hill outside Jerusalem where Jesus died, where darkness reared up and did its best to extinguish the light that had come into the world on that night. But the darkness did not overcome it. Those are the words of the Gospel of John. The darkness did not overcome it. Jesus did not stay in the grave. Death did not overcome life. Darkness did not overcome light. You need not live your life in darkness. We know it is there. like this Christmas of all Christmases, we know that there's difficulty and there's darkness. But the whole point of this story, the whole point of this performance, is to say that Jesus is the light and Jesus is with you. Jesus said, whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. When the light comes, what do you do? Well, what do the people of Brooklyn do? If I can have a photo of that. What do these people do when the light is there? They go to it. They seek it out. They stand in it. They look for its warmth. This message, it isn't a kind of sentimental pastoral scene. It's not a moral lesson. It's not ethical advice. It doesn't give us a self-help technique. It is the message that light has come and that there is no need for us to be stumbling and tripping through the shadows of our own life. We can stand in the light, make for it, draw near to it. It's the only way that we will find our way. Other offers of light will disappoint. We can't guide and find ourselves. We must follow the light, and the light is Jesus. Jesus says, whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. I'm just going to pray. I wonder if you would stand with me. If you've not received this light, if you feel like you're stumbling in the darkness, then now is the time to receive it. Now is the time to stand in it, to feel its warmth, and to let it show you the way. You know, as the Bible begins in darkness, it finishes with light. In Revelation, that terrifying, scary book about the closure of creation. It finishes in Revelation 21 with a city. And the verses read, the city does not need the sun or the moon or to shine on it, for the glory of God gives its light, and the Lamb of God is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor to it. On no day will its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. This gate is never shut. The gate is never shut. Jesus always welcomes those who come and live in the light. So let me pray, and then I think there's more singing. Father God, we thank you for this brief time together. We think of everything that's happening outside. We think of all the people who are full of fear and concern at this moment. We think of people who are burdened with sadness. We think of those that are ill, and ask Father God that you will bring light into this situation. Bring light also into our own situations. Lord, we all know the places where the darkness is threatening to take hold. Father God, be with us. Lord, come again just as you came on that day. Fill us up just as you filled the light, the world up with your light. May we at this Christmas time understand what you're doing and saying, even now, 2,000 years later. May we enjoy ourselves. May we see family. May we have a great time. May we feast. May we receive and give gifts. May we also remember that any gift that we give or receive is just a little sign, a little pointer to the gift that you have given. In Jesus' name. Thank you.
and in your lives, God is with all.